Just going to call the Premier.
Thank you very much, Speaker. I rise to advise the House that I will answer questions today for the portfolios of Water, Police, Public Transport, Roads and Road Safety, Multicultural Affairs, Community Sport and Youth.
Thank you very much. Are there any questions? The Member for Kew.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Premier. Are Labor ministers, MPs and staff being called to give evidence to the Anti-Corruption Commission over matters relating to internal Labor affairs, having their legal costs paid by the taxpayer?
Call the Premier.
Well, thank you very much, Speaker. I'm not privy to who is, has been or will be called to IBAC. So on that basis, I'm unable to answer the question put to me.
Supplementary question, the Member for Kew.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Has the government put a cap on the amount of legal costs that the taxpayer will pay for ministers, MPs and staff appearing at the Anti-Corruption Commission?
Order. I warn the Minister for Government Services, the Premier.
Thank you, Speaker, and I thank the Member for Kew for his supplementary question. I'm not entirely sure whether he heard the answer to the substantive question, but I think that answers it.
Order. On a Minister's statement, I call the Premier.
Thank you very much, Speaker. I'm delighted to be able to rise to update the House that today the Minister for Health, after decisions made last night and yesterday by the government, announced a $258.95 million investment to support our frontline health workers in the surge to deal with the increased admissions, the increased acuity of care, the big task, the massive task that they face in providing the very best care to everybody who needs it as we deliver our roadmap to in turn deliver the national plan. Now we know and understand that our nurses, our doctors, our ambulance paramedics, our cooks and cleaners and ward clerks and orderlies and the whole team across our health system, they do amazing work every single day. But for those who are in those patient-facing roles, for those who are under extreme pressure, and just to a certain extent, Speaker, there's pressure across the system, not only do we say thank you, but we also have today made announcements to provide additional support by virtue of shift allowances for those who are doing extremely difficult work under unprecedented circumstances, one in 100 year circumstances. What we know is they are highly skilled, highly trained, people of compassion, people of absolute dedication, and have given so much over these last 2 years. They do, in any year, they give of themselves like very few others, if any. It's appropriate that we provide these additional allowances. I want to thank those unions who represent health workers for their deep and meaning, the very meaningful engagement that we have had, the deep engagement that we've had with them. I want to thank each of their members and beyond, those who work in our health system, for the amazing work that they're doing. As we heard from Michelle, a nurse unit manager at the ICU at the Royal Melbourne Hospital, they are always there for us, and they will be there for us, and they need to know, Speaker, that their government is there for them now and over these next very difficult months.
Call the Member for Kew.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Premier. Noting the Member for Narre Warren North has resigned from the Ministry after being adversely named in anti-corruption hearings, will the Premier stand down other ministers who are also adversely named in these anti-corruption hearings?
The Premier.
I won't thank the Member for Kew for that, because it's simply wrong. It's simply wrong. The Minister was not stood down. As a clear examination of the facts, he rang me, he resigned, and that, I think, puts an end to the rather, well, I don't know what you'd call that. It's simply wrong. It's simply factually wrong. As is so much from the Honourable Member for Kew.
On a supplementary question, the Member for Kew.
My question is to the Premier. Have staff in the Premier's electorate, former ministerial or current Premier's office ever been used for branch stacking operations?
Order. The supplementary question needs to relate to order. relate to both the substantial question and the answer provided. So I offer the opportunity for Member Q to rephrase his question so that it relates to the answer and to the question.
Noting the Premier's previous answer, have staff in the Premier's office ever been used for branch stacking operations?
Order. I rule that question out of order. It doesn't relate to the substantive question. The Minister for Mental Health on a...
Sorry.
Order.
No.
On a point of order, the Member for Ripon. Order. Ask the Minister to resume his seat. On a point of order, the Member for Ripon.
Thank you, Speaker. On the ruling you've just made, the point of order I raise is in relation to these are clearly to do with the anti-corruption hearings that are going on right now. And so I would...
The Member for Ripon has a call.
And I would argue that questioning the Premier about... There's currently a Min staff member on the stand at IBAC. And so... It clearly there is an issue that staff and ministers are related here, and I just would argue that they are. It is a legitimate question.
Order. I just wish to order. I'll rule on this point of order. I'm happy to take the member for Q's point of order in a moment. Just so that the House is aware, supplementary questions are able to be asked at the conclusion of each answer to an oral question without notice. The questioning member may ask the responding minister a supplementary question to elucidate or clarify the answer. Supplementary questions must actually and accurately relate to the original question, must relate to or arise from the answer, and must not be a separate question on the same topic. So there are some key tests there for a supplementary question to meet for it to be in order, and I'll offer the opportunity for the Member for Q to rephrase his question. On a further point of order, the Leader of the Opposition.
Just on a further point of order, Speaker, the primary question that was asked of the Premier related to the current anti-corruption hearings, which is being conducted over branch stacking. The supplementary question which was asked of the Premier was a direct, indirect relation to the current inquiry, which related to the primary question over branch stacking. It even mentioned it. So one is in direct correlation to the other.
Order. Okay. So order. The Leader of the Opposition, I think, is correct in that the subject matter of the substantive question was the same, but as I've just read out, a supplementary question must not be a separate question on the same topic, and that's what I've ruled. On a Minister's statement, I call the Minister for Mental Health.
Thank you, Speaker. Speaker, October is Mental Health Month in Australia, so I rise today to update the House on key recent investments made by the Andrews government to support the mental health and wellbeing of all Victorians during this challenging pandemic. Speaker, on the 14th of September, I was pleased to announce a $22 million package to deliver fast-track, tailored mental health care to those who need it. We have now delivered, in total, nearly $250 million in dedicated COVID-19-related mental health support since March of last year. As part of this $22 million, we've invested in 20 pop-up community mental health services across the state, with around 90 dedicated clinicians providing an additional 93,000 hours of support. Speaker, I'm thrilled to update the House on the rollout of this program, specifically that we already have 11 of the 20 sites up and running, taking care of vulnerable Victorians in their time of need. It is with huge thanks, Speaker, to our fantastic community health providers that we have new services operating within weeks of our announcement, a testament to the dedication and commitment of the mental health sector. As of last week, we are providing new services in Mildura, Ballarat, St Kilda, Kensington, Sunshine, Melton, Frankston, Ringwood, Shepparton, Warrnambool and Abbotsford. The remaining 9 sites, Speaker, are almost ready to open and accept new patients, bringing all 20 services online by the end of October. Speaker, we haven't stopped there. From yesterday, that additional investment providing statewide coverage for the Triple P Positive Parenting Program is now up and running, ensuring that more than 20,000 families whose children are dealing with anxiety get the guidance and the support that they need. This is a government, Speaker, that steps up time and again to ensure the mental health and wellbeing of Victorians is front and centre of our roadmap out of this pandemic.
Call the Leader of the Opposition.
Speaker, my question is to the Minister for Health. New South Wales is 70% fully vaccinated and residents there are permitted to eat and drink indoors in a restaurant, pub or cafe at a density of 1 per 4 square metres. When Victoria reaches 70% fully vaccinated, will the government permit Victorians to do the same as New South Wales?
Call the Minister for Health.
Thank the Honourable Leader of the Opposition for his question. And can I congratulate the New South Wales community and people for reaching the 70% double dose figure and acknowledge that in doing so, they're more than, I think, 120-day lockdown, which started substantially before the Victorian current lockdown and which, of course, had the unfortunate byproduct of having seeded into this state, right, leading to our current situation of widespread community transition, and indeed the Australian Capital Territory being in similar position. And New Zealand. And indeed, the Victorian government, indeed the New South Wales government, all states and territories have signed up through the national plan agreed by National Cabinet for how arrangements regarding each state's jurisdiction will deliver those key gateways of 70% double dose and then 80% double dose, taking into account the epidemiological conditions, the particular circumstances that apply both geographically and to a community status in each of those states. And in that regard, the Victorian government's plan, which has been transparently out there for some time and is backed up by the Burnet Institute's modelling, is a safe, careful and measured process that will get us through the gateways of 70% double dose and then 80% double dose, and then based on the public health advice, we'll do so in a way that rewards Victorians for their outstanding effort. But in doing so, also we'll make sure that we don't put unnecessary and unreasonable demands on our public health system. And in that regard, not everyone agrees with that proposition. There are those who would risk inundating our public health system in how they would go about throwing open, in unreasonable set of circumstances, those measures. We acknowledge and congratulate the New South Wales government, the New South Wales people and the New South Wales community, and I am confident that given the different timing and the different vaccination support that each of those states have received from the Commonwealth, that in the not too distant future, the Victorian community will be following a not dissimilar path, but on basis of Victorian conditions to make sure that when we open, we reopen carefully, sustainably and safely in a way that rewards Victorians but protects our public health system.
Supplementary question, Leader of the Opposition.
Given that New South Wales is following the National Cabinet plan, why has Victoria chosen to break with the plan and refuse to ease restrictions on vaccinated residents in the manner of New South Wales and at the time National Cabinet agreed?
Order. Order. Minister for Health. Order. Order. If members could cease interjecting, could I ask kindly the Leader of the Opposition to repeat the question? The Minister didn't hear it.
Given that New South Wales is following the National Cabinet plan, why has Victoria chosen to break with the National plan and refuse to ease restrictions on vaccinated residents in the manner of New South Wales and at the time National Cabinet agreed?
Minister for Health.
Can I thank the Leader of the Opposition for his supplementary question? Perhaps the Leader of the Opposition failed to appreciate the answer to the substance, the substantive question. Victoria is delivering in full on the national plan to reopen. The national plan, the Honourable Member may wish to read, and the Victorian roadmap, together with the full release of the Burnet modelling on which the Victorian roadmap to reopening is based, is also been released in full. Those positions, clearly acknowledged by the Commonwealth Government, are full delivery of the national plan. Whether it be the Prime Minister, whether it be even the Federal Treasurer or indeed the Federal Minister for Health. All of those acknowledge that each of the state jurisdictions are delivering their arrangements in accordance with the national plan in full. The Victorian Government is doing precisely that.
Order on a minister's statement. I call the Minister for Government Services.
Well, thank you, Speaker. And I rise to update the House on how the Andrews Labor Government is leading the nation with the integration of vaccination certificates into the Service Victoria app. We're asking Victorians to get ready for when the state reopens by loading their COVID-19 vaccination certificate into the updated Service Victoria app. When they check into a cafe or a hairdresser in a few weeks' time, Victorians can show two ticks at the door. One tick that you've been checked in and one tick that you've been fully vaccinated. And it's as simple as easy as that, Speaker. And Victorians think it's simple and easy too. Just a few minutes ago, around 500,000 Victorians have uploaded their certificate since yesterday into the app. And the latest advice that I've received is that the number is growing by 10,000 certificates every 10 minutes. We know that Victorians want to get back to doing what they love, Speaker, whether it to be to visit a pub, a gallery or a live music event at the bowl. I've been working collaboratively with my state and federal colleagues to make sure this technology provides an easy customer experience for Victorians. And the feedback we received yesterday was that it takes just minutes to transfer your certificate across. The team at Service Victoria have worked tirelessly, Speaker, in recent times to make sure this technology is available for Victorians as quickly as possible. And I want to acknowledge and thank them for their unwavering efforts and support throughout the course of this pandemic. Speaker, the people of regional Victoria are the first to test out this technology as part of the vaccinated economy trials. And we look forward to working with venues and businesses in the coming weeks to make sure our technology and systems are good to go for when the state reopens.
Well, the member for Shepparton.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Minister for Health. Recent media reports indicate that Australia will allow 2,000 overseas nurses and doctors to enter Australia for work under a plan being finalised by the Commonwealth and states to ease the current healthcare staffing crisis across the country and particularly in regional areas. The Prime Minister and others have indicated that for double vaccinated entrants to Australia, home quarantine will become the quarantine solution in the near future. Minister, what steps is the Victorian Government taking to facilitate overseas workers being quickly brought into Victoria, quarantined and deployed in areas of need?
Minister for Health.
Thank you, Speaker. And can I thank the member for Shepparton for her question? That's a very timely contribution from the Honourable Member. And can I just take this as an opportunity to thank the Honourable Member as for the leadership she has shown in recent times in her community for the community-led response of dealing with some very challenging circumstances in the Goulburn Valley and Shepparton in particular. In regards to the specific issue that she raises, yes, the Victorian Government is in active consideration of that very issue, again, in accordance with the processes that the National Cabinet has set out. In regards to in the health sector, for instance, just a few hours ago, the Victorian Government announced a process whereby we will be bringing forward over the next 4 months 1,000 international arrivals in our clinical and healthcare services to bring largely returning Australians. Over 60% of that 1,000 will be Australian clinicians, nurses, allied health professionals, others to return to Australia together with some 400 international professionals in the same fields. And that is, of course, to replace the pipeline that has been turned off now for some 21 months, where historically Victoria and other jurisdictions largely relied on 700 to 800 arrivals each year into our health services to ensure demand was being met. The same also applies in regards to, for instance, the agricultural workforce. And only yesterday I'm advised that in accordance with the COVID safe plan, some further Pacific Island community delegations of agricultural workers arrived in the state through the arrangements that we have partly in place with our friends in Tasmania, bringing to some 3,000 workers in that space now in the state. add all that together, together with other work in other specified sectors, whether it be the creative industries, whether it be specialised engineering and other sectors, as Victoria and indeed the country moves along the process of a highly vaccinated community, we are increasingly able to decouple the restrictions and the quarantine arrangements from the relatively strict 14-day hotel quarantine system to a more nuanced risk-based system based on where individuals are coming from and their vaccination status in doing so. We are working cooperatively with the Commonwealth and with other jurisdictions precisely in the area the Honourable Member has mentioned, and we will have more to say about that shortly.
Member for Shepparton on a supplementary.
Thank you, and you've already touched on my supplementary question, which really relates to our forthcoming fruit harvest. Arrangements are currently underway for double vaccinated workers from Samoa to enter the country for the forthcoming harvest. They are currently destined for hotel quarantine in Tasmania at significant cost to both Victorian government and to the farmers. Will the Minister for Health advocate to the Chief Health Officer for ongoing farm quarantine for these workers, given the rapidly changing landscape and the imminent easing of restrictions and the fact that we're moving towards a 70% double vaccinated community very shortly anyway?
Minister for Health.
And again, can I thank the Honourable Member for her supplementary question. Much of the area in which the Honourable Member refers to have been the work under active consideration by my Honourable friend, the Minister for Regional Development and Agriculture. Can I thank her and her team for their active leadership in this space, which goes to the substance of the issues as opposed to perhaps somewhat more prosaically her federal counterpart, who seems to make announcements lacking substance as opposed to the hard work that the Honourable Minister puts in to deliver on these programs. So what we now have is some 3,000 workers in that system supporting Victoria's farmers across those two tranches of Solomon Islander workers that the Honourable Member refers to. In regards to how the transition from 14-day hotel quarantine to alternative arrangements based on that risk matrix, order. I will undertake to make order. The representations the Honourable Member has
the
requested.
The Minister's time is concluded. The Minister for Housing on a statement.
Thanks very much, Speaker. And I rise to update the House on the economic stimulus being created through our record-breaking investment in social and affordable housing. These investments, of course, include our $5.3 billion big housing build, the most significant in the history of Federation. They also include complementary programs such as building new homes to fight homelessness, our public housing renewal program, and our new innovative ground lease model. These initiatives were designed to provide more homes for more Victorians, to create jobs where they're needed most, and to drive the economy. And Speaker, this is exactly what we are doing.
Oh, good on you.
To date, Homes Victoria has engaged 59 building companies who have started construction on 485 sites, 195 in metropolitan Melbourne. Are you ready for this, Pete? Metropolitan Melbourne, and 290 in regional Victoria. There are now 4,000 homes under construction, and 15,000 jobs have been created. To put this in perspective, Homes Victoria's funding activity is expected to be 8 to 10% of the entire Victorian residential construction sector for this financial year and next.
Wow.
Projects recently announced under our Social Housing Growth Fund Rapid Round are progressing, and additional builders will be appointed in the coming months. And these investments have positioned Victoria to generate significant economic activity through the pandemic and beyond. And every dollar, Speaker, invested in social housing is an investment in Victorian people, and we continue to deliver on this record investment. Everyone, Speaker, deserves the dignity of a roof over their head, and I'm proud to be part of an Andrews Labor government that's achieving that important social outcome.
Member for Kew.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Premier. Have staff in the Premier's office ever been used for branch stacking operations?
Premier.
Thank you very much, Speaker, and I thank the member for Q for his question. Not that I'm aware of. Staff in my office and staff across the government, staff in my office work extremely hard every day of the week to support the people of this great state in the delivery of our policy agenda, whether that be removing more level crossings, not only saving TAFE from others, but making it better than it's ever been and free for so many, building literally hundreds and hundreds of new schools and upgraded schools across our community, making kinder free and accessible and 15 hours for the vast majority of three-year-olds, supporting our nurses and doctors and AMBOs and everyone across the health system, not just with record funding, record capital works investment, but also responding in the midst of a one in 100 year event with that surge capacity allowance announced today by my honourable friend, who's doing an outstanding job, the Minister for Health. I can go on and on. That's exactly what my staff do. I'm not sure what the member for Q's staff get up to, but what my staff are about is working hard every single day to deliver our commitments for the Victorian community. I am happy to go on because there are many, many more of them. Suburban roads, regional roads, mental health. The biggest reform agenda in mental health in the history of this nation. You can add up pretty much every new dollar in mental health across the country and you won't get to the investment that the Treasurer put down in the budget delivered early this year. Family violence. My honourable friend, the Minister for the Prevention of Family Violence is here in the chamber today. Not only Australia's first and only Royal Commission, but the full commitment to deliver every single one of those recommendations. Better attitudes towards women for better outcomes for women. Safety for women and children. More support, $3,500 million, more than every other government across this country combined. As I said, there are too many of these things to refer to, but they are all part of the precious gift given to us by the Victorian community, their trust and their mandate to get on and get things done. And that's exactly what my team and I and my staff do every day, every week, every year that we have the honour of governing and leading this state.
Supplementary question, Member for Q.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Currently, former state government staffer Ellie Schreiber is giving evidence at IBAC about her participation in branch stacking activity. Is her legal representation being paid for by the taxpayer?
Point of order, Leader of the House.
Again, the House would appreciate your guidance on how that supplementary question is relevant to the substantive question. You ruled earlier today and made it very clear to the member for Q that the requirements that needed to be met for supplementary questions to be in order. I'd suggest you rule this question out of order because it is not does not relate to the substantive question in an adequate way, as you have ruled just a few, probably 20 minutes earlier today in question time.
Member for Ripon on the point of order.
Thank you, Speaker. The original question by the member for Q asked about staff, ministerial staff of the Premier. All ministerial staff are employed by the Premier, and so this is clearly a staff member of the Premier, so it clearly relates to the original question. It also, I've got to say, talks about both the substantive and the supplementary relate specifically to the corruption hearings that are going on.
Order. I don't uphold the point of order. The question, supplementary question, I believe was relevant to the answer and the question that was asked as a substantial question, the Premier.
Thank you, Speaker. And I thank the member for Q for his question. I'm uncertain as to the exact status of the person that the member for Q references. I understand she was performing executive assistant functions to a then minister. I'm not sure whether she was a departmental secondee, a member of administrative staff, or a member of ministerial staff. However, regardless of those matters, I'm just making it clear I'm not certain about her status, but further to the point that the member for Ripon made in relation to all ministerial staff being essentially employed by my chief of staff, right? I'm just to that point, I'm not certain about what her status is, staffing status is. In relation to her legal representation, the first that I was aware that she would be appearing at IBAC, I don't know that I necessarily met her, I may have, was when I saw press reports of that happening. So I am uncertain if she has legal representation in the first instance. I don't even know whether she has counsel. If she does, I'm equally uncertain who's paying for them. If I can add anything to that answer, I...
The Premier's answer is concluded. Order. On a minister's statement, I call the Minister for the Suburban Rail Loop.
Thank you, Speaker. I'm absolutely delighted, Speaker, to update the House on the terrific progress we are making towards building the biggest transport infrastructure project in Victoria's history that's going to support jobs, services and opportunities for people closer to where they live. Not only will this project slash travel times by up to 40 minutes for a one-way journey, depending on where you're going around the city, it'll take 500,000 cars off the road each and every day. It's also a project that's going to create jobs, Speaker. Jobs in the construction pipeline, 24,000 of them, and more than double of that in the supply chain, Speaker, because we know that construction jobs support a whole range of other jobs in small business, in manufacturing, in engineering, right across our economy. This is also more than just a train line, Speaker. As I said, it will support jobs in precincts, better access to education and health services, and also more homes for people closer to important train station locations. It's a transformative project that will change the way people move around our city and state. It's been a very big few months, Speaker, for the Suburban Rail Loop. We've released the comprehensive business and investment case. We've got a tender out for initial and early works with work to start next year. And just last week, legislation passed through this Parliament. I'm really would like to acknowledge the Members of Parliament who wholeheartedly supported, without amendment, without trying to put amendments, to this important piece of legislation, Speaker. There were some amendments put forward, Speaker, by those who oppose this project, trying to amend into the legislation their ongoing opposition to the delivery of Suburban Rail Loop. Well, we rejected those amendments, Speaker. Amendment that was supported, unsurprisingly, by the Liberal Party and, surprisingly, by the Greens political party, Speaker. Who would have thought that the Greens political party would have not wholeheartedly supported a public transport project? Well, let it the record stand, Speaker. Only Labor will get on and deliver this vital project.
Question time has concluded.